I made myself very clear. My allegiance remained only as long as you assured the girl's safety. This Knight of Kareem does not forgive betrayal. Even a broken woman deserves a dignity.
Who is there? Someone there? Anyone? Oh, sweet champion. Where have you been? Please, your touch. The little creatures, how they nip and bite.
Hello everyone and welcome to Dark Souls 3 with me, Sergeant Snug. Now since the last episode I have learned a few things. I did find out what happened to the woman with the miracles, as you've seen in the bonus footage just before this scene. Yes, it does seem I have gone and cocked up some of the storylines. I looked into some of the others as well, and yes, I have. Such as the first guy who died and he was meant to be replaced, but I didn't die enough times and return to him to get my bonuses before I got to the catacombs, and that completely nullifies the entire questline for him. And the woman, because I bought that, I built that miracle, Gnaw, which is a bad spell, it made her storyline go into a downward spiral, which I regret. I know I'm going to be a good guy, I'm a good guy. What I was supposed to do is buy all of her good miracles and not buy any of her bad ones. Oh well, lesson learned, there's always New Game Plus. I'm definitely going to be paying a lot more attention to them in the future because I really wanted to see these storylines. You know, you constantly meet characters and such. And you hear them and you get these stories and you get to summon them for bosses. I haven't actually managed to summon a single NPC for a boss except for that one time. And then he died instantly. Because he kept trying to shoot them with arrows. Now we're trying to explore this place, which seems to be the same shrine, but dilapidated and broken. Rubble is blocking off all the exits except for one, which is the exit. And this is going to be something completely different, isn't it? Ooh, the sun is... a lot. Whoa. This place got fucked up. This place got fucked up royal. It is a gorgeous view. Wow. Is this like in the future? I thought it was the first flame. Oh, I didn't read what happened there. What happened there? Okay. Thought I was lighting a bonfire. Kiln of the First Flame. I'm not about to face the final boss, am I? Because there was something like this in Dark Souls 1 where you went down to the bottom. You had to fight a whole bunch of black gnat. Oh. Well, looks like I just have to go up there, but all these summon signs. No, I don't want to rest. I'll take a Sunbro with me. Pocky. Oh, no. Or Bendig, no. Felipe. Alright, Felipe. I also am going to add in a little clip of just how bad the online fucking shit is getting. Oh, right. Oh, look. Wow, I've already been invaded by a guy up there. I wonder if my good guy summon is going to come in. Oh, no. It's a bloody lagger. These guys are annoying as shit because you can't fucking see their animations. You can't tell when they're rolling. You can't tell when they're casting big ass spells. This has been an issue with the game for all day. I had some fights earlier and it was just... Look, I mean, look at this. I can't see any animation. How am I going to do this PvP fight? Or dodge attacks? He's going to heal. I wonder if he sees animations from me. Maybe he doesn't. That's why he didn't dodge that attack. And he fell off the cliff. This is ridiculous. They need to fix these networking issues. But this actually does look like a final boss fight. There was a big guy in the middle. It was the king. And the only way to kill him was to fucking parry every single bloody attack. Alright, then let's have a look at this boss. Chances are it's going to be a parry boss like last time. Soul of Cinder. We just swapped his play style. Whoa. Trying to play defensive. Poison. God, if that was toxic. This guy's casting pyromancies and fucking sorceries. There's a talent for you. And he's swapping weapons regularly. Seems my follow me there has glitched out like I did into the boss. Not taking damage, except for AoEs. Or he's dodging like a pro. I figured he was dead. That's why I was going all nuts. This music is unique to this boss, so I'm guessing this is actually... the final boss. I don't know who he is. I mean, last time it was the king. This just says Lord Soul of Cinder. And he's doing miracles. He's just meant to be essentially everything. That's going to come back down. Oh, that's so beautiful. And that's that. Wow. Just like that. Good one, guys. Well, they're still around. Oh. What happened to that? Oh, no. There they go. And any minute now, baffling. There you go. Oh, wow. This gift, really? Yeah, it feels a bit like Dark Souls 2 in this respect. I was expecting a full fucking episode of content, and this is the end. Or at least, it could be. No! Don't credit sequence me, man. Ah, oh, man! It... Oh dear. It feels more like the ending of Dark Souls 2 than Dark Souls 1. In that... There wasn't the build-up. I mean, in the first one, you start off with a very cryptic clue. Get the bells, the bell at the top and the bell at the bottom. You ring the two bells, then all of a sudden Sin's Fortress opens up. You go through Sin's Fortress, you get to Anor Londo, and then you kill everyone, and then you get back, and then it's like, oh yes, I need you, I've got this soul vessel, I need you to fill it up, and then you get... You have a new quest, you go on your second quest, you kill everybody, and then it's like, you need to kill the thingy person, the Lord of Cinder, and ignite the flame. I can't believe I killed the boss in the first try. I shouldn't have taken the summons. I'm probably going to do a playthrough where I just solo every single boss, I don't take any summons in, and see if I can do it, but... Oh man, it can't be the end, this is going to be the shortest episode I've ever fucking done. It's a good game. I'm hoping they add a lot of DLC to this, and they don't take too long about it, or don't price it too high. Oh my god. I feel the story is lacking, but at the same time, that's my fault. There is a lot of storyline in this, I just missed it, or didn't do it. And I also didn't know that this was the end, or I would have, I don't know, added some PvP in or something. And it's such a shame that the lag. I mean, I feel like I should do an offline mode play of this game, just because every person I summon will be an NPC, and there won't be any lag issues like this, where you saw the exploit I was doing earlier, where the boss wasn't moving, it wasn't attacking. The only reason I died in that fight is because he did an AoE. That's part of his sort of cinematic sequence. Good game, but it has its issues. Actually, in all honesty, the majority of its issues are just network and that I didn't know to be careful about what I do when it comes to the NPCs and to be thorough. I still didn't find out what happened to the thief. I found out what happened to the onion guy. He wasn't a traitor from the start. He actually gets his armor stolen, but I didn't actually go back and do that part of the story, because I didn't expect the ending to be here. I expected it to be like, oh yes, I need you to go kill this, and this, and this, and this, and then you'll be done. My other criticism will be in that you needed a central figure to tell you what to do. In Only of Ones, it was the Fire Maiden, the person who was taking care of the flame, and I mean, in the first one it was a Firelight Shrine. Your first hint was given away by an NPC just sat around. Then it would switch to another NPC, then another NPC. They would all have comments about what you're meant to do or what you're doing in that part of the game. This one, not so much, but that could be because I didn't have the NPCs around when I should have. It is good. I highly recommend it. And the fact that you've watched me play through it means you know everything now and you've seen all the spoilers. So, you've either got the game or you're not going to play the game. Oh man. I just can't believe it's over just like that. I was expecting to come home, pop on the game, play several hours of it and still not be done. But I am looking forward to a replay. I'm going to do some research on things to avoid. I'm not going to look up what happens in the storylines, but I'm going to look up how to progress the storylines. I will probably make a video of those separately, just as a sort of a final thing, and then the rest of them will probably be me solo killing bosses. I'm not sure if that'll be a New Game Plus thing, or if I'll start afresh, because, well, I'll do some research, because in Dark Souls, originally, there's like the soul level thing where you saw where everyone was, you know, within 10 levels or so, but in New Games Plus, the restrictions were off. You could pretty much pair with anyone, so I might find more PvP in a New Game Plus, or I might find it in lower levels, but at the moment, if it, this network issue is not fixed, there's no point. I can't do PvP fights where the enemies just stood there like a fucking ragdoll and I'm getting hit by invisible attacks not knowing if they're rolling, if they're blocking, if they're pulling back. But the good things about this game though, let's just not make this a negative critique, let's make this a positive critique. This is a fantastic game. The controls are solid, they've refined it to an art. Yes, they did have that small issue where if you get knocked on your ass or your character stuns for a brief second, the last commands that you did while that attack, while that stun happens, will happen occasionally by accident. Like, sometimes I might just get up and then use a healing flask or I'll roll or I'll attack. I don't want to do those things, but because it was the last command I entered, it will do it. The weapons are fantastic. There's a huge variety of weapons. I didn't use any boss weapons, and I'm going to be looking forward to testing them all out and trying different builds, especially builds I don't usually try. A magic build, for example. I never play a magic build, and I love the miracles in this game. I'd love to make a magic build bit centered around these miracles. Maybe less armor. Oh, let's see. Journey 2 can be initiated from the Shrine Bonfire if you don't wish to begin now. No. I'll do it later. I don't know if I want to start a New Game Plus just yet. Because I have all the access to all of the things now. And yeah, I've still got poison. Whew, what else can I say about this game? I mean, everything's great. I mean, unlike the first one, this is not a port. I don't think this is a port. But it looks gorgeous. Graphics, phenomenal. Gameplay, on point. Networking issues is a problem, a huge problem at the moment, but it's a AAA title, it's very popular. PvP is pretty much a centric feature of this game. They cannot have this. I mean, look, even this guy, who's just showing up as a little temporary vision, is lagging. Now, I know it's not me, 100 megabyte per second internet connection, and it's working perfectly fine. I have no lag anywhere else on any other program, and everything loads super quick. I mean, I'm not behind a firewall or anything. The forums absolutely lit up with errors like this, and YouTube videos just showing off that they can't handle PvP in these scenarios. I want to try. One thing I really wanted to try was the various covenants, and I didn't do that because this is a Let's Play, and you want to see. Well, I guess I wanted to show you the game, the whole game, but I really should have taken my time and enjoyed the covenants. I will make videos of me trying out the covenants, such as the one where that you can the person has to get from one end to the other, and it has two invaders coming in and fighting with the mobs. I can't remember the name of the covenants, I'm sorry. The Wolf Covenant, where you attack people in Farron's Keep. If they ever fix it, the Blue Sentinels or the Moon Blades, they are a thing. I was getting the Covenants mixed up, they are a thing, the Moonlight Blades. I angered the NPC with the questline, which is why she didn't show up. Otherwise, I would have been in that Covenant. I'm half tempted just to make another series, just of me playing the game, showing you the more active content, but more likely it'll just be PvP and me solo killing the bosses. That will be it. It won't be me running around and killing things and exploring the map, because you've already seen all that. I've shown you all that. Not much else to say, really, but thank you for sticking with me through this Let's Play, and I hope you enjoyed it. I apologize for all the various technical faults that happened in the start, and the occasional times where I wasn't talking very much. I just get into those sort of mindsets when it's late at night, and I don't want to speak too loud. I do have a housemate, although the wall is fairly thick. I don't want to yell, because that might wake him up. The walls are not that thick. Yelling does go through, though. Yeah, there will be more content. Sergeant Snug is not done with this game yet. I would like to say thank you all, and to all, a good night. Sergeant Snug, signing off Dark Souls 3, just for now, on a 20-minute episode. I'm so sorry, that's such a short episode. 1. There is some bonus content. Yes, I am including all of my boss fights where I replayed the game and fought all the bosses one-on-one, mano e mano, because I feel like I didn't really bring justice to this Let's Play. I felt like it felt cheap. Every single boss I fought, I summoned some players and let them do all the work, and I looked like a fucking coward and didn't know how to play the game. I can't stand it. So I went back and I killed all the bosses by myself, not overpowered but with a new character. As you can see here, I think I actually put this fight in the game at some point as bonus footage, but what the hell, might as well include it because I need some time to have some commentary. This is the strength character that I remade, and I really love this character. I'm probably going to remake it because I've since, I've respec'd this character. And I've run out of respec slots, so I'm going to make a new one and rebuild this build, because now that I know how to play the game properly, I think I could do a lot better at it. So yes, there is a lot of things I want to say. This is not the last episode, that is a promise. There is 2 bonus areas that I have yet to do, and I will let you know right now, I do not summon someone for the hardest boss fight in this game. And I know it's the hardest boss fight because I've looked around and everyone says it's the hardest boss fight. And I go, I kick it. Well, I don't kick his ass, man. Jesus Christ, I can't wait until you see it. I'm not going to put any spoilers in, but expect a very long fucking episode. Anyway, there are some things I'd like to discuss. In fact, let me bring up a little note card here that I've been working on. It's called the Dark Souls 3 Critique. I was thinking of making this an entire episode, because I have a lot to say in review of this game, and then not all of it is positive. I mean, if you want to skip this part, it's perfectly fine. You can go to the bonus content and such, but this is essentially a mini review. As you can see there, I've just defeated that first boss. Now, one thing I will say actually just now is, I don't do all these bosses solo. This was meant to be my story playthrough, where I was doing all the characters and stuff, and I noticed there was NPCs or something. I was like, oh crap, maybe I have to summon NPCs for the stories. So I do summon NPCs, but only NPCs. It does make some of the boss fights a bit easier, but the NPCs really don't come in on very, very difficult fights, except maybe Pontiff. I'll maybe do add him in later dates, because apparently he's meant to be really hard solo. But yes, back to my review. All I can really say about this game is, it's too easy. Now I know what you're thinking. You've watched my Let's Play up to this point. How can I dare say it was too easy? I looked like I wasn't having any trouble whatsoever. The fact is, I approached this game like a complete noob. Even though I played the previous two games, I had a basic knowledge of how to use the fighting mechanics. It should have been a lot more punishing. I should have been dying dozens of times every single level, getting absolutely pissed off, to the point that I correct my behavior, to the point that I change my loadout and try new things. But nope, I didn't. Now, here's the thing, why do I believe the game is too easy? Well, I've played Dark Souls 1, and when I played that game, I was absolutely terrible. I died so many times. I mean, unlike this playthrough, I died maybe a dozen, maybe two dozen times in the entire playthrough. In Dark Souls 1, I died hundreds of times. I remember doing boss fights so many goddamn times that the mob stopped spawning. And I think that's like 20, you have to kill a mob 25 times before it stops spawning. And that's a lot of effort. Try and kill one boss. So, I'm going to just get to it. Point number one. The reason that Dark Souls 3 is too easy. There are too many bonfires. Well, way too many bonfires. There's a point in the game where you just entered the swamp, the first part of Farron Keep. You start off at the top of the hill, talking to the two guys at the bonfire. You go down the hill, take a left, there's a bonfire. Okay, you kill the boss. You get a bonfire for the boss. Then, like, literally 2 minutes down the road, there's another bonfire. About 4 minutes down the road, you get to the chapel, there's a bonfire, and then all the little shortcuts lead back to that bonfire. That's not too bad, but that's like five bonfires within half an hour's play. In Dark Souls 1, I remember there being points where it was like, you wouldn't see a bonfire for half an hour. You would be dripping with absolute glee when you saw that bonfire. And so, by having so many bonfires, death has very little consequence. You can die, and then you're like, oh no, I've got to run the entire 2 minutes to get back to my corpse. So, you're never really going to lose your souls unless you're a really bad player, or you're not playing cautious. Point number two. Invasions are too easy. Very too easy for the host. Every single time I invaded a host off camera, because I did a lot of invasions ever since I finished the game. Every fucking time you invade somebody, they are at the bonfire, summoning phantoms. This is because their bonfires are too fucking many. As soon as someone's invaded, they sprint their little asses to the nearest bonfire and start summoning people. And there's another point right there. Summon spam is a huge problem for invaders, because there's no limitation to how many people you can summon while you're being invaded. There's no fog wall, which happened in Dark Souls 1. If you were invaded, the fog wall would block you off from any bonfire, so you could not summon any people's signs that were hidden around the bonfire. And because, well, what I think is that they should put an animation the same way as when you're writing your name on the ground for you to summon something. You should have to get on your knee, touch the symbol, and then it will summon them. Because at the moment, you just go into this world and some little twat is rolling away from all your attacks going AA on all the summon signs, and then people come in, you kill them, they do it again, you kill them, you do it again, you kill them. I've seen videos on YouTube that have gone on for like 20-30 minutes of poor bastards fighting non-stop invaders. It's absolutely stupid. And that's the thing, they should bring back the fog doors. Once you're invaded, you should not have access to the bonfire. You should have to fight your invader one-on-one or two-on-one or whatever. If you have summons, then fine. But Jesus Christ, stop this stupid spam. Next point, there are too many embers. In Dark Souls 1, you had humanity. Humanity was gained by killing mobs in an area up to a point if the boss was alive. If the boss wasn't alive, you didn't get any humanity. And humanity was a thing that was attached to you. It wasn't an item. So you would gather the same way of souls, humanity. And if you died, you'd drop to humanity and you'd lose one humanity. So they became a very valuable resource because you used humanity to buff your fires to get more Estus Flask. But now that it's an item, you don't lose that. It's another lack of a consequence when you die. You don't drop your fucking embers. All you do is lose the ember that you've gained. But embers are so easy to get come across. You can purchase them, you can find them, you get them as a reward for playing, for being summoned. And the thing is, you not only get your ember back, but you also get an ember as an item when you get summoned, and successfully so. So it's too easy to stack them up. So I don't think that there should be any embers like that. It should not. It's way too much. Makes it way too easy. Embers should be precious. They should be hard to get, or at the very least challenge. I understand getting an ember at the end of being summoned, but you shouldn't get it as an item. You should get just your ember status restored. Anyway, next up. There are way too few traps and ambushes. I remember Dark Souls 1. I remember it starts off right at the beginning. The boss ambushes you. You get scared shitless. Then you go further in and you get a person shooting arrows at the end of the hallway, and then you got to run past it and dodge it. Then further in, you get ambushed by a bloody ball coming down the stairwell that smashes you into the wall. Dark Souls 3, I can't think of an ambush, that, or at least one that succeeded, except for that in the prison where I got pushed off the ledge, but I didn't die from that. I should have. It should have been punishing or something. But no, there are no ambushes in this that are effective. You needed to employ that cheap killing tactic a hell of a lot more. Either that or I was just being too cautious because I'm used to that sort of shit. Next, bleed, poison, toxic, curse, frost are hugely underused. I mean, think about it. The entire playthrough of this game, has there actually been any enemies that employ these tactics very well? No. In fact, there are extremely few enemies that employ these tactics. Poison, for example. I can think of maybe two or three mobs that use poison or toxic. Curse, I can think of only one enemy, two enemies that employ curse. And frost, like one or two mobs. Bleed, again, one or two mobs. These fucking things should be employed a hell of a lot more. A fucking hell of a lot more. Poison, as ever, is useless. It doesn't do any damage. There's an entire swamp. You can just run through it. You occasionally have to use your fucking Estus Flask. Big fucking whoop. Toxic, very rarely yet again. Only one or two mobs use it. It's not a threat. I mean, there's one tiny little swamp area where the ground toxics you, but by then you're smart to it. It just needed to do a hell of a lot more. Because I remember in Dark Souls 1, you had those bloody bastards with the darts that would toxic you, and they fucking would ruin your day. If you did not have an anti-toxic thing on you at that point, and you wouldn't have access to it, because it wouldn't be sold by that point, you maybe have a very finite number of them, they kicked my ass. And curse, dear Christ, curse was a huge problem. It was mostly just those little fucking things that you have in this, the lizards, but even so, they employed it so fucking well. Next point, Covenant invasions. This is like the Watchdogs of Farron and the Bell Free Guys and such. It is too easy to avoid these covenants. It is flat out too easy. Do you want to know how you can get past all these covenants? Just don't use your ember. Seriously, just don't use your ember and you can not get through these areas without facing the vision. I'm sorry, but I feel like these areas should enforce invasions, even if you don't want them. Okay? You shouldn't have to be Ember to be attacked in Farron Keep. You shouldn't have to be Ember to be attacked by Aldrich. It's a bit like the Belfry in Dark Souls 2. It didn't matter. You would get attacked anyway. At least, as I recall, you used to be attacked anyway. Or the rats, the Rat Covenant. You would just get summoned out of your world into their world. That was fantastic. I think it should be mandatory, Embered or not, that you have to face PvP in those areas. Because that's the ability to just subvert it entirely ruins that experience. Curse is the next point I'd like to make. In Dark Souls 1, if you were cursed, it was devastating. You not only died, you not only got sent back to your fucking bonfire, dead as a doorknob, or whatever the hell that means, but you would lose a permanent chunk of your maximum health. It would stack again and again. Each time you were cursed, you would lose a maximum portion of your health, which also brings into hollowing. But that's the next point. Curse. You would have to get curse removed if you wanted to get rid of this permanent health debuff, and it was like half your health. It was not a small buff debuff. Half your fucking health is just gone permanently until you anti-curse, and that was costly. It cost you souls. You would occasionally find these items. You couldn't really buy them. They were a finite number, but that was amazing. It really made curse a very scary concept. And you would always be very cautious around those damn lizards. Hollowing. Yes, hollowing. In Dark Souls 1, yet again, I'm comparing the two, but it's my favourite out of the series, so I'm going to. In Dark Souls 1, if you died, you would lose your humanity, or your Ember status, and you would begin hollowing. Every subsequent death after that, you would lose health. This is different from Dark Souls 3 because Dark Souls 3 has your character has a specific amount of health, and then when you Ember, you gain additional health. You don't lose health by dying, you gain health by using an Ember. In the other one though, Dark Souls 1, you would have your basic health as your stats say they are, and then if you died, you would lose humanity. Well, not humanity did add a buff, but if you died, you would hollow, and the more you hollowed, the less health you would have. Every single death would lower your health even more and more and more, and I can't remember, but I think it also reduced some other stats like defense. What the hell happened to that? What the fuck? You made the game too easy by removing the punishment of death. Death needs to have a consequence. Stop removing the consequence. The sin system is next. In Dark Souls 1, again, you would have the sin system. If you attacked a mob or another player, you would have a sin put on your character, and this sin would... Christ, I can't even remember. Wait a minute, let me read my whole thing. Oh yes. In Dark Souls 2, at least, if you'd sinned by killing another player or killing an NPC, you would be susceptible to the Blades of the Dark Moon to invade you, and then you would lose a sin for every single time you would be invaded by the Dark Moon. This was fantastic because it meant if you're a PvP player who's constantly invading, well, eventually these guys are going to come after you and invade you and make your day suffering, which I really liked because I like being the good guys in these sort of scenarios. I like being the Blade of the Dark Moon, I like being, you know, a Blade of the Blue Sentinels, whatever. But those covenants never work. It used to be that you'd have to use a consumable item, which was annoying, but, you know, it worked, whatever. I enjoyed counter invasions, but now the Blade of the Dark Moon is an automatically summoned thing, like it was in Dark Souls 1, which doesn't really work because you have to be the same level as them, pretty much, using the same level of upgrade as them, pretty much, and in the same area, pretty much. There's too many fucking variables there. They also have to be wearing the fucking blue covenant ring, and I think that's always been a stupid mechanic. If you're a Blade of the Dark Moon, a Blue Sentinel, or a Blade, or all in the Blue Covenant, all three covenants should summon help if you are invaded. shouldn't have to be just the Blue Covenant, which is stupid. Anyway, let me read by the notes here, see if there's anything else about the Sin system. No, there isn't. Okay, next. Boss is too easy. It does sound like a brag, doesn't it? But seriously, these bosses are too easy, except two bosses. And ironically enough, here's number one. Aldrich. Aldrich was a fairly difficult fight. What with the spam of the spells keeping you at bay, and the arrows and the constant little wisps that she kicks out. That's difficult. And there's another boss, which is the hardest boss in the game, which you'll see in the bonus content. Fantastic, love that boss. My problem is, in Dark Souls 1, again, every boss was a challenge. Every boss felt like it had its own difficulty curve unless you summon somebody. I remember dying to everything so many times. The Capra Demon in that tiny little room with all three of its little dogs around it. That was absolutely difficult as all shit to me the first few times I did. Actually, I died to that dozens of times. It was one of the most infuriating experiences of my life because the room is so fucking small and there's extra mobs to worry about. If it swings its sword, it hits pretty much the entire area. Oh, God. And then you had bosses like Smaug and Ornstein, a two-hit combo boss. Two super powerful bosses, bosses in their own right, put into the same motherfucking fight. One of them's fast, one of them's slow, but one of them's hitting you with small attacks like fast hitting, one of you hitting with very powerful attacks, which absolutely devastate you. Smaug and Ornstein have pretty much stopped people's playthroughs. I have friends who stopped at that point in the game because they could not defeat Smaug and Ornstein, even with backup, because there's multiple of them. And that's one problem in Dark Souls 3. There are no multiple bosses. Yes, there are. Technically, you have the boss where you have the three guys fighting each other, and then they fight you. The thing about that fight is, one of them fucking is fighting the other bosses. It kind of defeats the point. You're not being outnumbered, they're fighting amongst each other. No, I need a challenge, and the Belfry Gargoyles, they were a challenge in their own right as well. I defeated them solo, I didn't know that you could summon people at that point, because that was my first playthrough of Dark Souls. That was a fantastic boss fight. Two bosses at the same time. I mean, you got that in Dark Souls 2, the same fight was repeated and it was difficult as shit. I needed that in Dark Souls 3. I feel they missed a step, and they're probably going to do this in DLC, because that is one of the most challenging things in the game, giving us multi-bosses. The bosses in this were fairly unremarkable, fairly bland. I mean, the lore behind them is fantastic, the aesthetic of them is fantastic, but the impact of them is forgotten. I feel like they could have done a hell of a lot more with these bosses, made them a lot stronger, have given them more phases. I mean, this boss has a phase where she goes all fiery and stuff. Well, I say she, but it's a he that's been devoured, but whatever. Yeah, boss is too easy, and the fact that you can summon people so easily into a boss fight, I just kind of feel like you shouldn't be allowed to. Or at the very least, if you are summoning people into boss fights, it should change the boss fight. the boss at the moment. I mean, at the moment, it just reduces the amount of damage that the boss takes. If you summon people, the more people you summon, the harder the boss gets on health. I think that they should get additional attacks or do different patterns. The more people that there are, more widespread attacks, more AoEs, you know, something that compensates for the fact that they've got multiple enemies. But no, they don't. They just make it too easy. And lastly, rolling is overused. This is more of a PvP jibe, but the game relies way too much on rolling as opposed to everything else. In Dark Souls 1, there were fights where you could only win by parrying. I mean, if you were fighting the Black Knights were very susceptible to parrying, and it was pretty much the only way to competently kill them. And the last boss fight, literally the last boss fight against the big host of Embers, or whatever the hell he is, the King of Embers, the only way to really competently defeat him is to parry his attacks, because they were parryable and it made him so much easier. To do so otherwise was a fucking chore. And then you've got blocking. Blocking is so underused in this game, because not only does it chunk off a huge amount of stamina, the chances are damage is going to go through it, and you're probably going to get staggered. And especially in PvP, blocking is highly discouraged, because there's ways around your shield. You can kick the person's shield out from them. Spell parrying. What the fuck is up with spell parrying? I mean, someone casts a spell at you, you time your parry with a special shield to deflect it. And deflect it does, except it doesn't. And what I mean by this is, it will deflect something like a soul bolt, it will deflect something like a lightning bolt. But any attack that has AoE on it, it doesn't deflect it. And even if it does deflect it, it goes around you. It doesn't bounce the spell back at the caster, which it fucking should. I mean, if you time a parry that fucking well, it should bounce back at the caster, giving it some purpose. Because why bother spell parrying if it's a high risk and no reward, if you can just roll for half the stamina? Yeah, why bother? I mean, I've parried people's spells, such as the Crystal Soul Spear. Thing is, it doesn't matter. I parried it perfectly. It bounced it. I saw it move around my character, like it was perfectly parried. But the AoE of it passing by my character did full damage. They just weren't thinking it. Rolling is just, again, I don't think combat should just be players rolling again and again and again. It should be, you know, this blocking should be a thing. Parrying should be encouraged. I mean, because at the moment, most of the parrying you see is just people doing 1-hit KO builds. They know how to parry, they swap out to a big sword and then kill you in a single hit. Oh god, I don't think I actually have time to do this full review. I might have to extend this, but this is my main critique. The game's too easy. Please bring back the brutal punishment of Dark Souls 1. And now a lot of people are going to disagree with me. A couple of people are going to disagree with me. Dark Souls 3 is not too easy. Dark Souls 3 is just as hard as Dark Souls 1. The only reason you found it easier is because you've played Dark Souls 1 and you know how to play now. True, you have got a point there, but with all the points I've made, come on man, they've definitely tailored this game to be more consumer friendly, more casual friendly. They need to bring back the gravity and severity of the punishment of death. I mean, I don't think I ever lost my souls, and even if I did, I didn't give a shit, because you could just get those souls back by grinding one boss for like 5 minutes. Yeah, I want the punishment back. I want, you know, half an hour of gameplay before I see a bonfire. I want to see, you know, my character struggling with the amount of Estus to ration it instead of just chugging it down like a fucking pint glass. And that's another point. How many fucking... You get way too many Estus flasks. You can get up to 15 Estus flasks. Fuck off. That's way too fucking many. I mean, sure, in the original Dark Souls, I think you could get up to 15 flasks if you fully upgraded your fire, but I feel it's too much. You should have to rely on spells and so on. So that's my main points out of the way. I don't have time to bring up the other points that I want to discuss. I just only have time to bring up these points of difficulty. I would love to go over what I think about poise. I would love to go over what I think about the fact that armor doesn't really make a difference. I mean, if you're pretty much wearing a full set of armor, you are getting the flat damage reduction that off every other thing. I'd love to talk about the whips and how shit they are compared to Dark Souls 2. I'd like to talk about the spellcasting and how absolutely terrible it is in PvP if the opponent knows how to stop a spell, which is aka rolling. Quite literally, a lot of spells you can just strafe in a circle, don't have to roll or run, and you'll dodge them if they're auto-aiming. The only time anyone can catch you in a spellcast is if they're free-aiming and are clever and very practiced. I'd love to talk about the fact that Frostbitten doesn't do jack shit. It really should do a lot more. I'd love to talk about the fact that there's a lot of weapons that have phantom range, which is extended range that is not represented by the model. It extends its hitbox, essentially. I'd love to talk about the fact that there's very little use of torches in this, or light spells. I mean, I'd love to have seen some very, very dark areas, but you don't see it. And I'd love to talk about the covenants and how they're not working properly, but they have been patched and they work a little better. But we're out of time. As you can see, I've just defeated the Aldrich Prince. And thus ends the episode. A short, abrupt end. I'll see you in the bonus content. Goodbye.